Another episode of Unsung. I'm your host, Mark Hopkins. For the next 20-some minutes, we'll try and take your mind off the troubles of the world, which is becoming increasingly more difficult, by talking to someone who's involved in activities that help us in our daily lives. We're on the web at unsung.us. The podcast is on SoundCloud, so give it a listen and share it. Today, I'm talking to Mr. Paul Leonard, who is the Township Manager of Upper Dublin, Pennsylvania, and he's a firefighter with Fort Washington Fire Company. And I got those two things backwards. He's a Township Manager, he's a firefighter, but originally for years I thought he was a firefighter, he was a Township Manager, but I don't know if it makes a difference. Thank you for coming out, Paul.
Glad to be here, Mark.
How did you get started in your first thing was township management?
No, actually, my first thing was volunteer firefighter.
You were a firefighter. Okay. Yeah. Okay. How long have you been a volunteer firefighter?
Since 1978.
How'd you get started?
I got married right out of college and moved in a small house in Center Square, Pennsylvania, which is Whitpain Township, just outside of Norristown in Philadelphia area. One of my neighbors was a volunteer firefighter. We're very lucky to have a small two-bedroom house, my wife and I. And I was looking to get involved in the community, and the neighbor said, why don't you come down to the firehouse Monday night? Had no background in firefighting. No one in my family had any background in firefighting. But Mr. Henry, who was one of the neighbors, said, come on down. And I did immediately understand it as it'd be an interesting way to be an integral part of wherever you lived. If you volunteer, you put a little equity into the community, you get a lot back, and that was absolutely true. And went down on a Monday night for their drill night at Center Square Fire Company. People were nice to me, and it became a advocation for the rest of my life.
How long were you at Center Square?
Probably about 3 years. I was in grad school. I ended up going back to Penn State, and it was actually while I was at in Center Square and just married, I decided I needed a better degree. I had a degree in English literature, which wasn't particularly marketable in 1978, nor today. And interestingly, you know, being involved in the community a little bit, saw local government as an opportunity. Penn State had a graduate program that was a non-thesis program. I didn't have to write a giant paper for 32 credits, and you know, I went to school and then started to get involved with local government directly.
So, were you an English lit major that didn't like to write?
Pretty accurate. That didn't know how to write. Interesting. I had to learn how to write. Certainly, how to do business letters and memos after my 4-year degree. I loved the literature. Don't get me wrong, you know, Penn State gave me some good basic skills in local government, and I have had a tremendous career in it. Not I don't want to say tremendous in success, but it's been very good to me, to my family, and it's been a challenge and a way to continuously be an integral part of the community.
How long have you been with Fort Washington?
22 years.
Okay.
I've been in 4 fire companies. So I ran a Center Square, went to the basic fire schools with them, had my first 2 or 3 working fires with them, and you know, like the challenge, like the notion of you know, you have to be ready for something. I like the teamwork. And then my wife wanted to go to graduate school and moved to Kent, Ohio. She got her master's at Kent State, and kind of a little hiatus there, and then returned to the Philadelphia area as the assistant township manager in Haverford Township, Delaware County. Haverford had, or has, still has 5 fire companies, and got a job in local government there. It's a pretty good sized community, about 50,000 people, and was, you know, actively involved with the community as the assistant township manager, learning my job. They were missing, or they were in need of day crew. So I applied for the Oakmont Fire Company right in Haverford. It's still there. Great little fire company. One of the five that served that community. And they wouldn't let me in. I still remember it today when...
They wouldn't let you in.
Yeah, they were... And this is kind of an ongoing theme. They were a little bit concerned that somebody directly affiliated with the township was going to be a volunteer. Back in those days, and to some extent still today, firehouses are a little bit of a cliquish or a closed culture. Back in those days, they had beer in the firehouse. And I think there was concern that somebody from the township was going to be a volunteer and might...
rat them out.
Yeah, your word for it. I misconstrue the culture. So they denied my application. I had all my certifications together, at least the basic ones I needed. And I took some offense to that and asked if I could speak to the Board of Governors at the Oakmont Fire Company. And just by chance, Mark, the day that they granted me a chance to talk to them and have a little bit of a hearing about their denial, because they really didn't give me a good reason for it, they scratched on a day call. And those in the profession of firefighting know that scratching on a day call for a volunteer fire company is not a good thing. It means you didn't get out the door.
You didn't do your job.
Yeah, you didn't respond, and somebody had to backfill, and or mutual aid had to take over. So that was pretty good fortune. You know, I went in and I explained to them that I'm not here to rat you out, to use your term for it, that I have some good training, they gave me a shot at it, and I ran with those guys for 4 years. And they couldn't have been nicer. You know, it's just a case of, it wasn't that they were bad guys or had bad judgment. They were suspicious.
They were suspicious and worried. It was just getting beyond that.
Well, volunteer firefighting, and this is, again, something I've, you know, grown to try to understand. I don't think I do. It's very tribal. You know, you run into another volunteer firefighter out there. You don't know if he's one of your own or if you should kill him. And I don't mean to... I'm joking about that, but it is a primal tribal experience that taps into, I think, our humanness that goes back thousands of years.
Yeah, it would not be hard to see many even business meetings just deteriorate into Lord of the Flies.
Yeah, I'm with you. And again, I've grown to really appreciate and love many things about the volunteer fire service, but that tribalism is not one of them. When I left there, they gave me a helmet, and I still have it today. You know, I only did 4 years. I didn't save anybody's life. I was not a hero. I was not a super firefighter, but I did my job, got out there, helped them fight some fires and also get the trucks back in service. And there's plenty of work in the volunteer service for somebody to do. And I hope in some way maybe broke down some of that concern about the township officials not being part of the team.
Well, yeah, you could have been part of knocking down the barrier, because I know that township employees are instrumental in daytime crews.
Absolutely, they are now. And it's a balancing act about, for a number of reasons, when townships allow volunteer firefighters to run calls, what's their role? How fast do they have to get back to work? How does it play into their insurance coverages, things like that? I've had good fortune with it. And in Upper Dublin, probably have 1, 2, 5 township employees that routinely run calls. And it helps out a lot, because many of them are good truck operators, have the skills and operate heavy equipment all the time, which is an essential part of being a volunteer fire response. A lot of them bring different skills from their jobs, whether it's a carpenter, electrician, dare I say, township manager, that really speak to the most positive thing I could tell you about the volunteer fire service, which is the eclectic nature of the response. On any given day, the alarm goes off. Any volunteer firehouse, at least that I'm familiar with in the United States, you don't know who you're going to get, but you also are going to get people with a wide variety of skills and background that can bring to bear that eclectic background and experience and skill sets to unique problems. There's not many fires anymore. The big secret in America is that the incidence of fire has dropped off dramatically, But there are still a lot of calls for service. And my experience, particularly here in the suburbs of Philadelphia, which do not have a high incidence of fire for the most part, is that the calls for service do demand a variety of
skills.
Things. Yeah, because they're unusual calls. There are weird things that happen where people need help, and you can bring to bear to that.
Well, it's I think the fire service more though than any other, and I see the search and rescue too more than EMS or police. I think that you have, even in non-emergencies, you have a bunch of different skill sets coming to bear on a problem because they're fixing something. We're usually fixing our own station, or we're working on something there. And it's you have these problems that come up, and somehow the tribe solves the problem.
Exactly, you know? Right. And you know, absolutely, that type of collective crew resource management, where you take a look and empower people to come up with different ideas, work within a command structure of some sort so that you still are empowered to say something, to throw in the unusual idea that might work, is a force multiplier. And that's been documented by a lot of the military studies on decision making and on any number of training programs that I'm involved with, is that that diverse background is powerful in solving problems quickly, provided the command structure keeps their ears open and encourages people to have that kind of input.
Yeah, and the best use seems to be when you've got a group of guys there with no uniform, with no rank or insignia on there solving a problem, just based on their knowledge of what they bring to bear on it. You know, I think that's really good. And like you said, fires are down. Rescues are still there, and there's certainly always going to be medical things, and houses are safer, and we've had talks on the show about that. Our responses are better. We're a little smarter in that way. In other ways, I don't know so much. Rescues, there's always going to be people getting their heads stuck in things, and that's never going to end, and people getting hands stuck in things and everything. There's always a need for that, and that's not going to go down. But I think that the fire service, like I see them, you know, they have engines that are also ambulances that can transport a stretcher in them, and that's I see the fire service becoming more of the medical service potentially, or merging in some way. And that happens at some firehouses. When you got started, what were some of the first lessons that you remember learning? Like, you talked about brotherhood and fraternity and things like that.
You know, I was never in the military, and I think one of the services that the volunteer fire service does for men, for young men, as I was then, or for the juniors that are in the firehouse I work with now, it provides people an opportunity, particularly men, to work among each other and understand the strengths and weaknesses of your partner or the other people on a team. You know, I was never a sports guy. I didn't learn football from you know, any coaches or any of that type of teamwork. But pretty quickly, and I think this is a real service for people, you learn to appreciate that the guy next to you might be great at one thing, but you also understand his limitations. He might not be such good another, and you have to take advantage of it as well as compensate for a successful team. It's a safe environment for people to do that. You know, when we have, and Fort Washington has a great and very strong junior program where kids, when they're 16, can start firefighting. When they're 18, they can, you know, be ready to go and do interior firefighting. And it's a way for people to find out if they have what it takes, a willingness to get their hands dirty, to, you know, get up in the middle of the night to roll hose in icy conditions, all those sorts of things. And to appreciate people that do it, you know, when they're 72 years old, as well as when they're, you know, 23.
I think that even the ones that don't work out go back into the community with a healthy respect for it.
Yeah, I hope they go back in the community and don't fall off a ladder. You know, I tell that when kids get started in our area. You know, if you don't do this, if you at least get through firefighting one, you'll never use a ground ladder the same way. And it's a basic skill set, you know, to say, can I safely put a ladder up against a house and not kill myself? And the fire service can give you those kinds of skills that maybe you're not going to get elsewhere.